Okay. Our last speaker for this session will be Pedro. He will tell us about randomized benchmarking for non-Markovian noise. The floor is yours. Hi, Pedro. Can you unmute yourself?
Yeah, sorry, can you hear me now? Yeah, sorry, I couldn't find the controls. Yeah, thank you very much. So just quickly, if you wanna look at the details of the talk that I'm gonna give today, you can go to this page. Just wanna thank quickly, so Minshu Xie, who is the leader of the of this role of this work. Kevin Modi at Monash in Australia, Rob and Tom, also from Queensland, Australia, and Felix from Monash in Australia as well. So just to set the stage of what I'm going to be talking about, so it's going to be about benchmarking quantum devices. So I don't have to convince you. I think that noise is the thing that is kind of killing us right now. When trying to use fault tolerant or to reach fault tolerance in quantum devices. So as you know, you cannot just get fault tolerant quantum computers from the shelf, right? Like you have to actually build these things through a whole process, which can be captured very nicely in this diagram by Stephen Flamia, which essentially is a process of prioritizing the types of noise that you want to take into account. Then you go measure things, then you fix the errors that you're getting, and then you verify that you're getting the right answer, right? And then you repeat this thing over and over and until you get a better quantum device. In general, we need precise characterization and control of quantum devices, so that is going to be the roughly the topic of my talk. Specifically, it will be the very first step, which could be to benchmark the different kinds of noise. So just setting some reference of the types of noise, the amount of noise that you're getting. Now, it has been over 10 years now, I think, that randomized benchmarking has become the gold standard to do this thing. And roughly what it does, RB, is to estimate average error rates of a given gate set. And the advantage that it has is that it requires very little resources and is insensitive to state preparation and measurement errors. Finally, well, it has been shown so in 2015 that it gives high confidence in the sense of for certain types of gate sets and or types of noise, you get very small variance in your results. Now, how does randomized benchmarking compares with other approaches? In a sense, it gives you very very low information about the amount of noise that you're getting. It only gives you an average, right, for your full gate set that your full yeah gate set that you can apply, but it requires very little resources, as I said before. And it compares, so you can compare it directly with full tomography, in the sense that in tomography you can reconstruct things very nicely, but it requires exponential amount of resources. Now, as I said, randomized benchmarking has been around for over 10 years, so there's a lot of different flavors that you can get randomized benchmarking with. Now, all of these different flavors of randomized benchmarking are subject to Markovian kinds of noise, sometimes also time independent in general or gate independent kinds of noise. So yeah, just to summarize in this picture, non-Markovianity and gate dependence in general are the things that everyone hasn't been able to do something meaningful, just because it's very hard to make sense of temporal correlations and so on in noise. Now, what is the standard protocol for randomized benchmarking? So in general, you would just prepare an initial state, right? You get there somehow. Then you sample uniformly at random. So this would be the kind of standard, like the most basic randomized benchmarking protocol. You sample M gates from the Clifford group uniformly at random. And then the last gate, you constructed specifically to be the inverse, so the sequence of inverses of all the gates. So that if your gates are noiseless, if they are ideal, then you would just get an identity, right? You wouldn't do anything. Now, that would in general not be the case, and you would have some added noise. Now, you can model this noise by just attaching some CPTP map lambda. Now, usually, so you can assume this lambda to be time independent, for example, instead of having lambda 1, lambda 2, and so on, you can assume that you get the same noise, right? That would be the simplest case. Now, what you do is, at the end, you can measure some QVM element M, and you can estimate these probabilities, right? If you project onto the initial state, so if you start with a ground state, and then you project in the end onto that ground state, then you can get a survival probability, so how far you're going from your initial state. Now, if you repeat this process N times, then you can estimate some average probability, which in general we call an average sequence fidelity, because you can relate it to the fidelity of the gates that you are trying to benchmark. Now, in the end, you analyze, well, how this quantity, this average sequence fidelity, behaves in the number of gates that you are applying, so the sequence length n, right? And in general, we will see that this depends on the assumptions that you make for these lambda maps, so the noise maps. Now, in the usual case, what you see, if you do this process, you see some behavior like this of the average sequence fidelity in the number of gates that you apply, right? And you can actually work out things analytically, and you get this exponential decay, which is an exponential decay because this p is between 0 and 1, and this p contains all the information from the about the noise, so about this lambda. Now, specifically, what this means is you go and you take this average, the average of the sequence of gates, right, which is simply taking these independent averages over G, over the gates that you apply. And if you're dealing with a multi-qubit Clifford group or any to design, which, by the way, it's usually a folklore claim that the Clifford group is always a two design, but it depends on the dimension. I just found out this recently, so that's a good comment to make right here. But anyway, if you have at least a two design, you can just use the second moment of the unitary group, and you get a defacing type of channel, right? Where this p can actually be less than zero. So yeah, in the end, we would consider p to be close than one. So randomized benchmarking works for that kind of noise when p is almost or is close to one. And in the end, so using that averaging formula, you can get this exponential decay. And explicitly, this p term is related to the noise in this sense. So it's just the trace. So you can think of this as the Liouville representation. So you have lambda, tensor lambda, right? The Krauss operators. And then you can just compute explicitly this p term. And you can also see in here that this can go below zero, right? And then you can see explicitly that A and B contain the state preparation measurement errors, right? And this will be just constant. So in that sense, randomized benchmarking is insensitive to these kinds of errors. Now, more generally, there has been this result. So Daniel, who I think is going to present later, and Hashag in 2018, this more recently by ICERT and others, Hels and Roth, Honorati, Werner. And in general, so whenever you assume Markovianity time independence and weak gate dependence, you get these kinds of linear combination of exponential decays. Now, what's the deal with non-Markovianity? Why hasn't anyone actually done this? Well, so I mean, to begin with, non-Markovianity in quantum stochastic processes is kind of still contentious and sometimes used ambiguously. So in the randomized benchmarking literature, you would find only that the noise is described by, or is not described by, completely positive maps, for example, which is true. And I'll tell you why, or you'll be able to see why. But in general, so non-Markovianity in quantum stochastic processes refers to some dependence on the full history of a process. Okay, now for you to appreciate this, I'll just take you back to the classical case, to the classical definition of non-Markovianity. So a process, a classical stochastic process, is Markovian if you get this satisfied, right? So the conditional probabilities only depend on the very last outcome and not on the full history. Otherwise, you would have a non-Markovian process. Now, what the implication of having this Markovianity condition is that if you look at full joint probabilities classically, and you use this definition of the conditional probabilities, in general, to compute a full joint probability, you would need to consider all these correlation functions, right? So all these conditional probabilities. Whereas if you have a Markovian process, you can only use two-point correlations. Okay, so this is crucial. Whenever we talk about non-Markovianity, we are referring to multi-time higher order correlations. Now, this is why I say the concept is still contentious in quantum mechanics, because the usual approach in open quantum systems is to track the evolution of your quantum state, and then you just say something, people can flag when you get non-Markovianity by measuring two-point functions, and this is necessary, but it is sufficient, but it is not necessary. So you can say, well, I'm getting non-Markovianity, but sometimes you may fail to detect non-Markovianity. Now you need to turn this concept to a multi-time notion, and that this is difficult to make because you don't get the Kolmogorov consistency conditions as straightforward. You cannot just say, well, we get full joint probabilities by looking at history of outcomes. Right, you need some dependence on the things that you apply precisely, because whenever you measure or whenever you interact with a system, you're actually messing up with it, right? You're changing the dynamics. So the idea is just a change of how we approach things. And instead of focusing on the underlying system, on tracking the underlying system in time, the idea is to track the experimental manipulations that you can do on your system. Okay, and from this you get a future state. Now I'm just flashing this table, which you can find in this paper, just to tell you that there is a full rigorous language to do this. Okay, and we know this framework by the term process tensor. Okay, so it is just a map from these experimental manipulations to quantum states. And then you get all of these mathematical conditions. So everything, it's just a generalization of a quantum channel. Okay. Now the idea, as Neil also introduced, is that you can describe your underlying dynamics in a full system and environment, right? So you have some open quantum system, and then you can do you can apply some control operations only on your system. Then in the end, you can measure. Okay, and this will give you a generalized kind of Born rule. Okay, and the idea is that now you can have some underlying dynamics, right, which you cannot directly access, right? The thing that you can actually control are these operations that you apply, right? The dynamics are out there; you're just kind of probing them. Okay, now the we know this framework in open quantum systems as the process tensor, or other people, so the original approaches in quantum stochastic processes were known as correlation kernels. But these objects are everywhere, right? In different fields of quantum mechanics. So for example, quantum channels with memory might be familiar. to the audience of this conference, but there are all other other names by which this process tensor is known, which might have different, or they might have different objectives or different little details in which they differ, but in the end they are the same basic object. Okay. Now the nice thing of this process tensor, or the one useful thing of this process tensor framework in our purpose, is that we can just do a contraction of choice states, right, of the full process tensor, which is this one. We can just put the operations, the control operations, in a tensor as well, which in this case would just be an uncorrelated tensor. And then we can just do this contraction and obtain the final state after the whole process occurred. Okay, now there is an analog of the classical Markov condition, which in this case only depends on the kinds of, on the instruments that you apply. Okay, you can see this in this paper. You can see this quantum operational Markov condition. Now, in our purposes, it just matters that the choice state of a Markov process will take this form. So it will just be an uncorrelated tensor with the individual choice states of each map taking you from step to step. Okay, and now we can just measure non-Markovianity as the minimum distance, so the distance to the closest Markovian process. Okay, with whichever relevant distance measure that you want. Okay, now for randomized benchmarking, we can just turn this picture that I painted before for the usual Markovian case, we can just turn it into a contraction of process tensors. So now we would just need to average this tensor of the Clifford gates that we apply, okay, or of any gate set that we apply. We can just contract it with the underlying dynamics, which now will be the noise, okay, the noise in the quantum device. Now, okay, this is just what I said. So we can now just translate this to a contraction of process tensors. And we can just, now to compute the average sequence fidelity, we can just compute directly the average of this tensor of operations that we apply, which in this case, we just restricted ourselves to unitary two designs, right? So Clifford gates, you can think of just this being Clifford gates, but you can do this for any kind of gate that you can think. Now, the main result that we get is that, well, instead of having this nice exponential decay, we get something a bit more complicated, but we can evaluate things analytically, which is the nice thing. Now, we get something that looks or that can be decomposed similarly as some A and B, okay? Now these are going to be maps, okay? And this B is kind of analogous to the B that you get in the usual Markov case, okay? And this A is the one that contains the error rates, so it will contain of the lambdas. This one also contains error rates, but it's a bit more complicated. You would need, for example, correlations in the initial state or something more complicated. But anyway, from here, what you can see is that you get the polarization. So you get this depolarizing effect from averaging only on the system, which is to be expected. Okay. Now I just have to tell you how these lambda, this dollar and these theta maps act. Okay. And they just act in this way. So even if this dollar map in this way looks a bit more complicated, they are just the trace, so it's just partial trace of the Krauss operators of this lambda acting on this state on the environment. Okay, and this theta function is just the noise acting on this environment with the maximally mixed state and then partial trace. Okay, so these are just environment functions. So in a sense, you're just taking the noise, the full system environment noise, you're just taking to environment, and in the end, tracing out the environment degrees of freedom. Now, the first thing that you would want to check is if you have perfect gates, right? If you don't have any noise, if you have just identities, then this would yield the trace of your PVM element with your initial state on the system, and effectively that's what we get. Now, as I said, this A and B are now the polarizing solely on system S, and the Markovian gate independent case, well, the Markovian limit actually reduces to what it should. Okay, so you just get some decay that looks like this, right? If the gates are time independent, if the noise is time independent, then you just get a single P as a power to the M, so you get this exponential decay. Okay, now a crucial difference is now that initial correlations can actually introduce non-trivial, well, only state preparation errors. Okay, now the first thing that one wants to look at is, well, how do we quantify how much non-Markovianity we are getting? Okay, and you can just define a similar kind of, well, a randomized benchmarking specific measure of non-Markovianity, which in the end just boils down of computing this difference of tensors. Now we get the subtlety of, well, what process tensor, what Markovian process tensor do we compare with? Because you are constrained to the device that you're trying to benchmark and so on, right? So we just thought of a fair comparison that you might do, which will be, well, you just trace out the environment degrees of freedom at every step. So you just think of some environment that is kind of forgetting between step to step. Mathematically, this would just be like a dilation map at every step, where we just take the original lambdas that you're actually seeing in the full non-Markovian case, right? And you would just need to attach a fresh environment state, which is up to some choice, right? So we still have that kind of degree of freedom to compare with. Now with this definition for a Markov process, we would get zero. We would get non-Markovianity zero. And now, so one thing that you can look from this definition is that you can just bound this with the non-Markovianity definition that I gave before. Okay, you can bound it from above. So even if you have, you can bound it, yeah. And even if you have a non-Markovian process, you can still, well, if you have, yeah, a non-Markovian process, you can still get RB non-Markovianity approximately zero, or yeah, practically zero. And we just dub this term as randomized benchmarking blindness. Okay, now the problem is if you don't know or if you don't have a model for either epsilon or epsilon Markov, then we need some alternative to do this. Now, usually what we thought about doing here is, well, usually the memory will be finite, so you won't have a memory of the full history. This is related to the concept of Markov order. Okay, so you can just suppose that the noise is non-Markovian, so it's acting jointly on system and environment up to some length L. Okay, and the rest of the sequence you can think of being fully Markovian. Okay, now if you have this kind of noise, then you can get this average sequence fidelity, which just has some contribution from the Markov part and some contribution from the non-Markovian part. Now the non-Markov part just turns into the spam, into some spam constants. And furthermore, if you start with an initial a uncorrelated state and you do nothing, so if you fix your Clifford's V identity until step L, right? If you have just idle time in your quantum device, then you can just turn this non-Markovian noise into a single Markovian block. Okay, you would have identities in here, then you can just collapse these three. So this is just an example for four time steps. You can collapse these three into this block, okay? Now, I don't have much time to... Okay, I think my time is actually over, but I'll just show you quickly the numerical results that we got. So this is just modeling some noise with this Hamiltonian. And you can see clearly the deviations, right? At least up to some sequence length. And then the observations, actually the variance or the, this is just error from the mean. You can start seeing that it's harder and harder to tell the non-Markovian contributions, right? As you go to larger sequence lengths. So this is just looking at these deviations. This is turning on the spam errors. So if you have this initial state affected by some rotation, with the Hamiltonian, and then the measurement affected by some rotation in Y, then you could get something like this, which if you make the errors much stronger, then you actually see that, things get really bad. This is just for finite non-Markovian memory. I think I'll have to skip this. If you're interested in this, you can ask me on Slack, because it's a bit, I would need to go through this detail. Anyway, we can also use this finite non-Markov noise to tell if you get if you have coherent noise. I can also discuss this on Slack because it's a bit elaborated. If you're curious to know about it, now there are many open questions. I just want to leave this this last slide here. There are many open questions, of course, in this direction. Now the first one would be, well, how can you, what can we do with this analytical expression of the sequence fidelity? Now, perhaps the most important would be, well, how can you get process fidelities? Right, in the usual randomized benchmarking scenario, the thing that is important about RV is that you can extract individual gate fidelities. Okay, so for non-Markovianity, it would be nice if we can get something as process fidelity. Okay, so quantifying actually how non-Markovian things are in your device. Now, putting also non-Markovian RV in a general RV framework for general gate sets or incorporating all other types of dependence, this is something that we are currently working on. And there are many other general questions, such as mitigating non-Markovian errors, or if noise memory can be used, actually can help you out in getting better fidelities. With that, I'll finish. Thank you very much.
Hey, thank you, Pedro, for the nice talk. We may have one quick question. Maybe I will ask one. Do you have any opinion like how to put this non-Markovian randomized benchmarking in the general randomized benchmarking framework?
So the idea in here is to benchmark, for example, general groups, right? So finite groups, that would be like a first step. Or to benchmark native gate sets, for example. So what I'm meaning with this general RV framework is to get some result. So some general result of this kind, for example. So saying a bit more about what shape the sequence fidelities take in for more general gate sets or groups. This is something that we're working on. And you can actually get this kind of result, so with quality, instead of getting quality parameters, you get some quality kind of map or quality tensor, which has to be a tensor or a map because you have all the correlations, right, between step to step. But you can actually get some generalization like this for finite groups. And then, it remains to see if you can do the same for more general gate sets and so on. In the end, we also need some connection with, for example, process fidelity or some related concept. I just mean doing this kind of generalization to other gate sets and so on.
Okay, thanks. I think our time is up, and I would like to first thank all the speakers for their very nice presentations. And this will be the end of the first session, and the second session will start in 20 minutes. And you may stay here or just take a cup of coffee. Okay, thank you all for attending.